First and foremost, hello everyone. Thanks for joining us. My name is Caitlin Hurl, and I am the Manager of Corporate Relations here at A.S.A.P, the Veteran and Active Duty Spouse Mentoring Program. We are very pleased to have you join us for today's webinar, Becoming Wealthy, Exiting the A.S.A.P Lane and Building Mind Fitness. This event is being recorded and will be posted to our website in the coming days. Please feel free to utilize the chat box throughout the session to ask questions, but we do ask that you stay on mute in order to avoid any background noise. Today's speaker is Alan Steelman. Alan is a best-selling author, a former member of Congress, a former member of the White House staff, and former vice chairman of Alexander Proudfoot Company. He has been a chairman of the Dallas Council on World Affairs, a board member of Sterling Software, Aristocrat Technologies, and the Texas Growth Fund. He is a graduate of Baylor University, holds a master's degree from SMU, and was a resident fellow at the Institute of Politics at Harvard University. And with all that, I will turn it over to Alan so he can take it away for our exciting session.
Okay, Caitlin, thank you so much. And good afternoon. I'm not sure what time zones everyone's in, so it could be good morning and good evening, depending on where you all are. But thank you, Caitlin, and thanks to A.S.A.P for hosting this. You know, when I was preparing for this session, I went back and looked at the prior sessions that A.S.A.P has been offering, and I know all of you realize how truly blessed you are with the incredibly rich and robust content that A.S.A.P is providing and helping you transition to your next stage in life. And so I want to cover today something that is critical for all of us now. I think with the content that I've seen you're already getting, if WEALTH or even, you know, financial security is one of your goals, and certainly financial security should be one, you're certainly getting good content for that. There is, though, an even more important platform for all of us for whatever our ambitions may be, our aspirations may be, and that's being WELLTHY. Or what I'm calling mind fitness. So I think, you know, given what we have been through for the, you know, the past 16 to 18 months, this metaphor, life is like a box of chocolates, might seem to be a little bit strange. Although I would have to add, some of us do cope with stress and anxiety by eating a whole boxes of chocolates at one sitting. Which is not the most healthy and productive way to deal with stress, but I do think it's a good way to think about what we've been through and the importance of mind fitness. You know, the iconic film Forrest Gump, which won 6 Academy Awards, including Best Actor, you know, had that famous line from Tom Hanks, who was playing Forrest, which I just want to play right now, just as a reminder. We've all seen it, but it won't help to be reminded because it is, I think, a very fitting metaphor for the present time and what we've been through.
Hello. My name's Forrest Gump. You want a chocolate? I could eat about 1.5 million of these. My mom always said life was like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get.
And indeed, we don't. We did not. I think all of us of a certain age, including everyone on this call, certainly are well accustomed now to the twists and turns of life, you know, long periods of good, but also some traumas that come along and things in life that disrupt our normal pattern. And this poll was just issued last week following what we've been through for the last number of months, which is that a full 50% of Americans are not sure they will ever recover from the COVID pandemic stress. You know, we were already in the midst of an unprecedented mental health crisis before COVID, and now this is layered on top, which adds a whole new set of challenges. When we talk about mind to fitness. You know, we often, all of us, confuse the brain with the mind, and they are two distinctly different entities, which I want to cover. The brain, obviously, is something that we've all seen pictures of. Its elements are, if you've taken courses in biology or neuroscience, are well described. It's where all of our cognitive functioning takes place. The mind, on the other hand, is this mysterious, ephemeral, constantly changing place where our emotions, our feelings, our memories all reside. And some of you may have read the book Emotional Intelligence a number of years ago. And the author, a guy named Daniel Goleman, G-O-L-E-M-A-N, said that our EQ, our emotional quotient, meaning our ability to manage the mind, is far more important than our cognitive intelligence or our IQ. And so the mind is the topic for today. And I know all of us have probably known other, you know, highly functioning individuals with high IQs who had a very hard time in managing the other side of their life. So I want to cover the whole topic of mind fitness today. As you all think about the transition you're going to be making, if you've read motivational books, which I'm sure some of you have, this is a very famous quote from Napoleon Hill, written many, many years ago, that whatever the mind can conceive and believe, it can achieve. Now, the two operative words there are mind and believe. The mind is, again, that mysterious place where all of our dreams and aspirations reside. It's also where all of our self-limiting beliefs reside. I'm not good enough. I'm too old. I'm too young. I'm not educated enough. I'm overqualified. I'm too fat. I'm too slender. I'm not pretty enough. I'm too attractive for that job. Whatever those beliefs may be, you know, we all have those to deal with. And so being able to deal with the mind and to believe what our aspirations are and to have faith and confidence and conviction that we can achieve those is really what mind fitness is all about. So the message for today is we are living our lives in this anxious, stressed, addicted, and pressured lane. And obviously I've used the A.S.A.P. as soon as possible as a way of crafting this acronym. As I said earlier, even before COVID, we were already living in an era, the digital age, where the pace of life and all the stresses and strains were becoming too much for many who couldn't manage without opioids and alcohol and binge eating and other ways of coping. And in 2019, pre-COVID, there were 225,000 deaths from opioids, alcohol, suicide, and then other longer term from diabetes coming from obesity and so forth. So even before COVID, we were already living in a time that you know, required mind fitness coping skills, and unfortunately, too many have not yet you know, made that transition. The good news is, and there is good news, there is an exit ramp off the out of the ASAP lane. This session is all about you can do it, you should do it, and how to do it. So I want to cover that with you. One thing that we've all got to remember, and it will come as no shock to any of us, that whatever our coping skills are and our resilience, there's no way to control the external events in our lives. You know, things are going to happen that are outside our control. This metaphor of a surfboard is one that perhaps you've heard, that even though we can't control these external events, we can develop skills that will allow us to surf the choppy seas in our life and even the tsunamis like the ones that we just been through. So the exit ramp, exiting this anxious, stressed, addicted, and pressured lane, the six pillars of wealth, W-E-L-L-T-H. So the six pillars, if we're going to truly have mental balance and equilibrium in our lives, first and foremost, above all, is sleep. If you're sleep deprived, no matter how physically fit or whatever skills you may have, it's going to be very hard to function to your fullest potential. polls. I saw one just last week that 40% of the American people say that they're sleep deprived and are having difficulty sleeping. So we've got to first have that as our foundation. Then nutrition, eating well, eating properly, movement, all forms of physical exercise, hiking, biking, walking, yoga, going to the gym, doing weights, meditation, being able to calm the mind chatter and just be here now. Social networks, even before COVID, kids and seniors, so in other words, both ends of the age spectrum, were having a difficulty with this one. And I think all of us who've been in lockdown over the last few months have noticed how important our social networks are. And then if you've noticed the background that I'm using for this session, you notice if you've been participating in Zoom or Microsoft Teams talks, as you know, the host, or in my case, the guest host, can kind of choose the background. And so this is the Buffalo River in northern Arkansas. It is part of the wild and scenic river system. You may know we have, of course, everyone knows we have the national parks. We also have the wild and scenic river system. And I think there are 16 rivers that have been set aside where development can't take place and will be preserved for future generations. So nature therapy, which I'll elaborate on in just a moment. But given time constraints, I'm going to focus more on movement and particularly yoga, meditation, and nature therapy. I think we're all familiar with the need for sleep. We've probably read a lot about that. We're probably all struggling with ways to achieve that. Nutrition, we know that's important. And I think we all know the importance of social networks. Movement, as I mentioned, is all forms of physical exercise. The real magic in yoga, and I'm going to give you a number of examples, military examples, of where yoga is becoming more and more a practice within the military. Yoga is something that, men, so the book that I wrote, which I'm going to show you in just a moment, is focused on the other 88% of the population that thinks nobody like me does yoga. So Yoga Journal, which is the most reliable source of statistics on this, is there are roughly 40 million practitioners of yoga in America. These are mostly white females living in an urban area with enough disposable income to pay for instruction. The other 88%, and again, we're living in this this unprecedented era of mental health crisis. The other 88% are men who generally think, it's not macho enough, or I see these young women doing things that I can't do with my body. I'm not going to go in there and get embarrassed. Seniors who think they're too old. Kids and teens and college students who are too busy with both thumbs on their digital devices. Latinos and African Americans. So those are the other 88%. So the book that I wrote, I was focused on those who need to be converted. And I'm going to, when we get to the neuroscience part of this today, I'm going to go through really why yoga has so much healing power. Meditation, the mind chatter that we all have to deal with, or the monkey mind as I refer to it, regrets about yesterday, worries about tomorrow, our to-do list for today, just the ability to be here now and to calm that mind chatter. And I'm going to cover some meditation techniques at the end of today's session. And then nature therapy, again, referring to the Buffalo River background I'm using, there's in Japan, the Japanese, by the way, even more stressed than we are, and burnout and suicide rates are even higher than here. They call it forest bathing, F-O-R-E-S-T, as in trees. So there's a natural chemical in all plants, including trees, called phyton, P-H-Y-T-O-N. Pronounced as like fight on, but spelled P-H-Y-T-O-N. So trees and leaves and all use it to fight off viruses that can attack and kill plants. The human brain, it's a real calming, has a real calming effect, this chemical does, on the human brain. So when you're out among the blue sky and sunshine and water and trees and blue sky, then you're getting a good shot of phyton, which is why you feel so much better when you're out in nature that way. So nature therapy being the sixth pillar. And I'll elaborate more on a couple of these as we go forward. The book on the left is the one, by the way, that was mentioned in what you all received about the program. So I'm going to give a copy of this to, I know we said the first 25, but I didn't write this book to make a lot of money. It's already made the bestseller list on Amazon. So I'm going to give a copy of this, an inscribed copy, to any of you who want one. If you'll just send in your mailing information and the name you would like inscribed to Caitlin and Gianna, I'll be sure and send one to you. So I used the Wizard of Oz story to really say that was a lot more than a children's fantasy tale. It's really the story of all of our lives. As you remember, Dorothy and Toto get picked up in Kansas by a tornado, dropped into the wonderful land of Oz. The good witch Glinda, the first one that Dorothy encounters, says, if you and Toto want to get back to Kansas, if you'll stay on this yellow brick road, over the rainbow there's a wizard and he'll get you back to Kansas. And Dorothy says, well, we're off to see the wizard. So along the way, of course, the scarecrow needs a brain to make wise choices. The tin man has had his heart cut out to make something for someone else. He needs to be in love again. And the cowardly lion, who's the king of the jungle, but he's a coward. He's embarrassed. He said, I need courage. Well, come join us. We're off to see the wizard. Well, they get there. And do you remember, the wizard turns out to be a false wizard, a wrinkled up little old man. And so how's that the story of our lives? We all have to deal with tornadoes. In fact, we just dealt with one, all of us together, with what we've been through. We all deal with brain fog, like the scarecrow. We all have heartbreak in our life, either failed relationships or deaths of loved ones. We all need courage at critical times. Unfortunately, too many of us think there are external wizards that can heal this for us, including, unfortunately, things that, as I mentioned earlier, opioids and alcohol, binge eating and other things. So that's what that book is all about. And I've got, and as you see, the subhead is exiting the ASAP lane. So there's a whole several chapters on how to do that. Managing Your Monkey. Now, this one is not out yet. I'm about 80% done with this one. But here I'm using the full six pillars that we're discussing today to talk about managing that mind-chattering monkey that we're all born with. If you think about it, God gives us breath the day we're born. Unfortunately, we also get that little monkey that, resides between our ears our entire life. I don't know whether any of you have been to a rainforest or not, but I went to Costa Rica maybe 10 years ago, the first time I was ever in a rainforest. And, the humidity is just dripping from the trees, the birds are singing, and those monkeys are chattering and jumping from limb to limb and just going crazy the whole time. So that's where the monkey mind metaphor comes from. And unfortunately, that monkey never takes a vacation, never takes a day off, never rests, never goes to sleep, and deprives us of sleep. So when we reach a point where the monkey is making our lives unmanageable, that's when we need to start making a change. Brain fog, something that I think we all deal with, certainly when we wake up in the morning, and if we're leading a highly stressed life, brain fog is a good way to describe what we're dealing with. Your brain on mindfulness just being be here now, the ability to deal with the brain fog and to deal with the monkey. So that's what it looks like there. Now, the science that I mentioned earlier, this is the real magic, particularly in yoga and meditation and in the six pillars. So on the right, and you've all seen this diagram many times in biology or whatever courses you've taken in neuroscience. So when we're calm and we're rational, if you can see my cursor, can everyone see that? So that's the prefrontal cortex. So our eyes, our ears, our nose, our mouth, our feelings are all taking in whatever we're seeing and processing that and making, rational, balanced decisions about it. Now the amygdala, if you can see the cursor there, that when that is triggered, that triggers our fight or flight response. So a woman walking through a shopping center at night with her purse and she sees a threatening looking figure and she says, I better, get to the car and get in there and lock the door. So your amygdala is triggering that fight or flight response. And that of course is a very constructive function for the amygdala. It is also, when you're dealing with PTSD, what is getting triggered by events that are reminding you of past events in your life. Now, the vagus nerve, which is the most, by far, you may, if you've never heard of this, it's pronounced just like Las Vegas, but spelled V-A-G-U-S. It's far and away the most important nerve in our body. It's the 10th cranial nerve, which attaches to our brain on the back, runs down both sides. And it goes, it connects from the brain through every organ in the body, heart, lungs, blood, pancreas, colon, prostate, ovaries, everything. And so when you're chronically stressed or acutely stressed, the cortisol in your brain, which is the fight or flight brain chemical that gets triggered, when you're acutely or chronically stressed, then your entire body, through the activation of the vagus nerve, is carpet bombing everything in your body with cortisol and stress, which over time, not only causes premature aging, but medical science today says 95% of cancers are caused by unregulated stress. So it's doing enormous damage. Now, the good news is that in addition to breath, on the day we were born, God gave us a Walgreens or a CVS in our head with four feel-good chemicals: oxytocin, dopamine, serotonins, and endorphins. So when you're practicing yoga or meditation or using the six pillars, you are getting through the vagus nerve, all those four feel-good chemicals, which is why it is so calming. And I would add, by the way, that dogs, if you wonder why you feel so good when you go in the door and, you know, your faithful friend that never judges you, is never unfaithful to you, why you feel so good, you're getting a good rush of those feel-good chemicals, hugs and laughter, on top of, the physical movement also triggers the vagus nerve in those four feel-good chemicals. So that's the neuroscience or the magic behind particularly yoga and meditation. I've been partnering with the Center for Brain Health. Everything I just told you, by the way, regarding the science, I've been partnering with the Center for Brain Health at the University of Texas at Dallas for the last several years. And again, these slides and this presentation will be on your website for you all to go back and look at if you choose to. So this gives you even more on the science behind this. And Dr. Diana Purvis-Jaffin and Dr. Jimmy Holland were my two partners. There's an old saying that facts tell and stories sell. Some stories, my own personal, we all lead three lives. We have our public life, the storefront that we put on at work and to our friends, our private life when we go home to our family. And then there's our secret life that we sometimes don't talk to anyone about. In my own case, there was a bipolar gene on the male side, on my father's side. Three of his five brothers had it. My dad had it. Was depressed most of his life. I had one sibling, one brother. By pure luck of the genetic draw, I didn't get it. He did. And he committed suicide at age 35. Family financial struggles all through high school. I had jobs all the way from the sixth grade on, which, by the way, turned out to be a blessing. It certainly taught me a lot of good things. But at the time, it seemed pretty hard to deal with. The imposter syndrome, something we all deal with. Certainly, when I got elected to Congress at age 29, and all of a sudden, Time magazine was saying I was one of the 200 emerging lung leaders in America. And my hometown newspaper, the Dallas Times Herald, said one of the best ever sent to Congress from Texas. And Texas Monthly Magazine said one of the five most effective members of Congress. Obviously, I treasured those plaudits because it certainly helped me get reelected. I did not believe all of it. And I had to manage that. And when you read a lot today, as more and more people are talking about their mental struggles, Lady Gaga and Ariana Grande and just on and on and on, who are talking about the imposter syndrome is something that that they deal with. Winning big, losing big in my own life, getting elected to Congress at age 29, 4 years later, losing a race statewide in Texas for the U.S. Senate, and you know, kind of really feeling at a young age that my life was over. It wasn't, but it's what it seemed at the time. I certainly felt like a ship at sea for 2 or 3 years after that. Getting fired as CEO of a job, a company about 10 years later from an aborted coup trying to oust the chairman. It was a mission I should have undertaken because he was a bad person, but he won and I didn't. So anyway, now to all of your lives and other lives. I mentioned earlier, yoga and meditation becoming more and more common in the military. This is a podcast that I did with Dr. Beth Funk, who is the wife of General Paul Funk, who's a 4-star now. He was a 3-star at the time. They're living in Virginia now. He was the commander at Fort Hood at the time, as all of you know, the world's largest military base. And so Dr. Funk herself, who was a real hard charger, had grown up in a military family, and was married now to a general, and she was a marathoner and, you know, a real, you know, Wonder Woman who burned out and collapsed from all the stress and strain of trying to be Wonder Woman. So she takes up yoga and that heals the things she was dealing with. So she opened up this yoga studio, which is now being run by her daughter since she and General Funk had moved to Virginia, to provide yoga and meditation for all those at Fort Hood. So Fort Hood warriors and downward facing dog, for somebody who do yoga, know that's the most famous pose in yoga. So Fort Hood warriors and downward facing dog, and featuring Dr. Beth Funk talking about military applications. So she and General Funk both are very active yoga practitioners and are real believers. Orlando Garcia, Desert Storm, Afghanistan and Iraq, injured himself, lost 6 of his boys, as he referred to them. He said, but the trauma was after he'd recovered, and because he was career, he wanted to go back to Iraq. And they said he was in no shape to go back, and basically he needed to retire. And he took that as being, they're throwing me away. I guess kind of the way I felt when I lost that race for the U.S. Senate, but he felt rejection. And he says, even today, that yoga saved him from being another suicide statistic. Charlene David Truesdale, both veterans themselves, run something called the Warrior Spirit Project. And their mantra is dogs, dirt, and yoga. I mentioned dogs earlier, so they're using service dogs. Dirt refers to farming and gardening, and yoga, of course, which I've already mentioned. There's a book, speaking of dirt, by the way, or gardening, or farming, there's a good book called The Well-Gardened Mind, if any of you care to get that, which talks about the beneficial impact of gardening on your mind and creating a more peaceful life. Fred Samis is an 88-year-old Marine, just proving that you're never too old. Fred practices chair yoga, a veteran of the Pacific in World War II in Korea, and he says it makes him feel calmer and more flexible. Deanne Wanler-Vukovic, another podcast guest of mine, and a 3-time suicide survivor, including a gunshot the last time. She grew up in a military family, enlisted in the Marines herself. After she got out, she had several really top jobs as a university administrator. The stress and strain of a divorce. She was living in New Orleans during Katrina. And some other things is what kind of drove her over the edge, she said the last time. Thankfully, she survived. And she's now a yoga teacher and a certified meditation and brain coach teacher, and a real believer in the healing benefits of it. I'm going to quickly go through these without telling you all their individual stories, but as I mentioned earlier, a lot of people say nobody like me does this. You know, they've still got that stereotype of what they see in pictures of, you know, a young, fit, white woman doing this, thinking nobody like me does yoga. Ricky Williams, those of you who follow the NFL know that he was a superstar MVP in the NFL, also the Heisman Trophy at the University of Texas. His secret life, I mentioned all of us having 3 lives, traumatized as a teenager by a sexual assault by one of his relatives. He never told anyone about it, but when he became, quote, famous, even more famous, trying to deal with that and the fame, And he was suspended, as some of you remember, three times for drug abuse, marijuana, in the NFL. And finally, after 13 years, said he's going to take more than marijuana. So he started taking opioids. And he finally said, I've got to get out of football. So he goes to India for a full year and studies yoga and becomes a yoga teacher. And so that's Ricky's story. Don Drake on the right of Ricky is a West Point graduate, traumatized by the verbal abuse by his father before he ever went to West Point. Don became a very successful banker in Dallas, had to have alcohol to cope, and finally said, I've got to get out of banking, and I've got to also got to change my life. So he left banking, and he now teaches yoga and meditation. Dorsey Standish, who's the bottom left here, Dorsey was a top engineering graduate from the University of Pennsylvania, was on a fast track at Texas Instruments. Also at age 25 got burned out, and she runs a meditation studio now and teaches meditation in Dallas. Fred, we've already talked about. This is Stephanie Tovar, a Mexican-American from San Antonio, who now lives in Dallas. She also had abuse to deal with from her father and one of her older brothers, and she now teaches yoga meditation to young kids. Which, by the way, the Dalai Lama, speaking of young kids, the Dalai Lama once said, if we could teach every eight-year-old to meditate, we could heal the planet of violence in one generation. So you might just park that one away, because it does have a real effect on you know, all the things that create violent acts. And Ebony Smith in the lower right-hand corner there, Ebony runs something called Yoga in the Hood, focused on the African-American population. And Ebony had also a real trauma from her earlier life. So I wanted to show you these just to show you that that's a pretty representative sample in terms of age and race and ethnicity and gender. So we all can do this, and we all should do it. Okay, the Land of Oz, as I mentioned, it's a long journey. It's often pleasant. It's sometimes dark and terrible. The real story is beware of the false wizards. And too many of us have been relying on the false wizards for far too long. We all come at some point in our lives, if we are dealing with something that is causing us to rely on something else to cope, where we're saying, you know, I've got to make a change. Now, you remember Robert Burns, famous poet, the path less traveled. There was a path diverged in the yellow wood. I could not take both. I took the one less traveled, and it has made all the difference. Meaning that there is a way, there is another path, and it can make all the difference. Now, if you're not inspired by poetry, you might need a Lucy moment, which is what I've always needed. You know, when things just pile up and you just can't take, you can say, this is bullshit. I can't take any more of this. So whether the fork in the road is a Lucy moment or whether it's the Robert Burns one, The Path Less Traveled, we all reach that point at some point in our lives. So there is an exit ramp, the yellow brick road, the six pillars. I think I've elaborated on these, and particularly on the yoga, meditation, and nature therapy. What I wanted to illustrate as we close out and go to our question session is the whole thing of meditation and mindful breathing. How do we get to now? So whether you just sit in a chair, lying flat in your bed, on a meditation cushion on the floor, whatever you take, I want to give you a few techniques here that you can use that will help you. And obviously YouTube is full of more instruction on this. So the Darth Vader breath is something like this. Here I am, I'm sitting in a chair. So I'm going to breathe through the nose. So I'm visioning an artificial hole, an imaginary hole in my at my throat level here. Now, the value of that is the wandering mind is a thing that we all have to deal with more than anything else when we're meditating. Calming that monkey, even the Dalai Lama says he has a hard time keeping the monkey under control. And the Dalai Lama is the king of all meditators, believe me. So I don't want any of you, when you pick this up, to feel like that you just can't do this because your mind wanders. It does for all of us. But that Darth Vader breath, that imaginary hole, does help keep the mind focused as opposed to, so it's usually on the down breath when the mind starts to wander. So the taco, now not everybody can do this with their tongue, but if you can see my, I don't know whether you can see that or not, but that gets oxygen to the brain quicker. So that's one that that a lot of people use. And again, not everyone can do that with their tongue. The alternate nostril method is another way of dealing with the wandering mind. So finger over your right nostril. So you're just alternating the nostrils, which is another way to keep focused on your breath and away from the monkey chatter. And then the bellows breath, especially if you're going into a difficult meeting, you know, and you've got performance anxiety or you're all stressed out and you need something real quick. So just breathing in through the mouth is four or five of those real quick before you go through the door, oftentimes will really help. And again, don't fret over the wandering. The monkey is always restless. It's always there. Just go back to your breathing. So that's your surfboard. We can't control the external events. We can use coping methods. So that your call to action, it's always tempting to say, well, maybe I'll do this or I'll do it later, which usually becomes, you never do it. We never do it, all of us. So if you have something that you are having difficulty coping with, you need to find your own moment of truth. If it's a Lucy moment, which is what I always have to do, make it a Lucy moment. Be clear, focus, most of all, execute. Execution, and you in the military know this, are trained in this way, but you know, there's an adage that vision without execution is another word for hallucination. So too many of us have dreams and aspirations or goals that we just don't have the discipline to execute against. Persistence, in the war between the rock and the river always wins. Persist, wear it away. You can tame the monkey. If you do it 66 days, that will ingrain the habit. If you just want a toe in the water trial, because you like to kind of test things first, breath and meditation for a few weeks. If you really want a deep water commitment, jump in with both feet, then yoga 3 times a week and meditation 7 days a week. So closing out, if you remember, Oz never gave nothing to the Tin Man that he didn't already have. Our own wizards are within. They're not external. Okay, thank you very much. Caitlin, back to you.
Thank you so much, Alan. And now we'll dive into a few questions. I know some of you submitted them in advance. If you have any additional questions as we move forward, please feel free to put them in the chat.
By the way, Caitlin, how much time did that take?
That was 38 minutes, Alan. It was perfect.
I was in politics, you all remember, once before, so talking with politicians is always difficult to keep in control. So
you did great. So let's start with this. What role do you think companies can or should play in employee wellness?
Well, they should play the most important part, frankly, because most of us spend more of our time at work than we do at home. And most workplaces, frankly, are toxic. In fact, I've spent a lot of my business career with a management consulting firm who focus on, in particular, the critical role that the sergeant plays or the first line supervisor, the one you report to on a day-to-day basis. They're the ones who should be the mentoring and coaching and the voice of the company and listening and learning. Too often, they're playing drill sergeant managing out of their digital devices and not spending enough time out being an engaged manager. So you can heal the toxic workplace through an engaged management style, and especially at the sergeant level. So yes, and companies not only have a higher performing group of employees, but it also lowers their healthcare costs. So it's incredible. It's incredibly important that the workplace be the place where this is done. And then of course you go home and you do it yourself, but the workplace should be doing it.
Excellent. And what are the top 3 things that you personally do each day in order to keep your mind fit?
Well, sleep first and foremost, which I don't always succeed at. Just on sleep, by the way, just to elaborate just a bit, because all of us struggle with that. And you've probably already read the part about trying to turn your digital devices off at least 30 minutes ahead of time, because the ambient light has a negative impact on our sleep pattern. A good warm bath is something I do before going to bed. Meditation. And of course, the yoga that I may have done several hours before. I do yoga 4 times a week, and you all don't need to do it that much. And so if I've even done it 8 hours before, I've still got that residual impact of the, you know, as I mentioned, the Walgreens in our brain we're all born with, or the CVS, depending on what part of the country you live in. So yoga, meditation, and sleep are the three that I really focus on.
We have one.
By the way, there is a natural chemical, melatonin, and especially as we age, the melatonin that we're given at birth tends to decrease some. So I also take 5 grams of melatonin every night. I've been doing that for years. It really helps you with jet lag, which is where I first learned how to use it. And it's natural. You're just supplementing what you were given at birth, and you've lost some as you've aged.
Interesting. Good to know. There's a question in the chat. Can you share an activity that will help you to recover from frustration during work?
Yes. Closing your door. And so there, if you've ever done yoga, there are 2 or 3 yoga poses that you can still do in a suit if you're a man, or in a dress if you're a woman. Standing up from your desk, touching your toes, putting your hands above your head, doing this to stretch out this part of your body. And then sitting back down with your door closed and doing about some of those, the alternate nostril breathing that I told you about, or the bellows breath if you're really frustrated about something, or your boss is getting ready to come in the door and talk to you about something. So those are just some things. I've got a whole chapter on that in the book, but those are just some things that kind of jump to mind.
And this one I find particularly interesting. Although living in a high stress environment generally has negative effects on you, do you believe that some people need this stress? Is there a danger in cutting back too much on that stress?
Yes. Stress properly managed is incredibly important. It's what gets us up in the morning. It's what drives our ambition. It's just unregulated or unmanaged stress that has all the negative effects that I was talking about. So, and we all have different levels of resilience in dealing with that. So it's important to kind of know what your level of resilience is. And if you're being pushed beyond your level of resilience, that's when you need to adopt some measures to help manage it. But absolutely, I mean, stress properly managed is a big benefit to all of us.
And in keeping with that, how do you balance ambition with these stress levels? How do you prioritize your well-being while still being ambitious and pursuing your goals and your career?
Well, a very important question. And I think too many of us, especially when we were young, as I did, was incredibly driven to achieve certain things, even though I was physically fit. I went to college on an athletic scholarship, so I was always working out and running. I did not understand the difference between physical fitness and mind fitness. And so I think what's really important is to, for example, the pursuit of WEALTH, which is one that too many of us, I think, put not only first and foremost, but to the exclusion of everything else. Financial security is very important. And if you want to become, wealthy, doesn't matter how much you want to achieve, just as long as you're also understanding the importance of work-life balance and mind fitness and doing things to give other parts of your life their proper role, your family, your kids, your relationships. I mean, they're, the stories of very wealthy, very unhappy, even suicides, are just everywhere, from people who achieved everything they wanted in the pursuit of money, but didn't give proper weight to everything else? So a very, very good question.
We have another in the chat this is a great question as well. If your manager, supervisor, boss is the main source of the ASAP feeling, should you have a talk with him or her?
Well, as I said earlier, the sergeant or the boss, the one we directly report to, has by far the single largest influence on how we feel about the company we work for, no matter, you know, what the benefits package is or anything else. So having said that, you should. I wouldn't confront. I would, we all have to be measured and diplomatic in the way we approach things. And, you probably know the style of your manager, whether they're going to be receptive to this or not. So it may be someone you can just cut to the chase with who you know is trying to do a good job and wants to be a good supervisor, but doesn't know how. There's one certain way to approach that person. If it's, you know, the drill sergeant, who just wants to be a tough guy or a tough woman and doesn't want to hear anything, then you got to come up with a different approach there. So I think you've got to decide based on the way you interpret the person and their response to this. But yes, I think you should.
And do you have any advice for dealing with the stress of adding back in the commute when things start to open up again post-COVID? How do you recommend people cope with that additional stress?
Well, that obviously can be a very stressful part of life. If you're driving, there are podcasts and tapes that you can listen to while you're driving. If you're riding the train commuting into Manhattan, for example, you can still, put your ear pods in your ear and listen to podcasts. And, I've been able to meditate on airplanes without people knowing that's what I was doing, because you just close your eyes and fold your hands in your lap and they think you're sleeping when you're really meditating. So yes, the commute, which is very stressful, I think, though, can be converted into a way to decompress as you're going into the office each morning and going home at night.
We have an individual on here that says their commute is 3 hours round trip. Do you know any particularly long meditation podcasts that you can recommend?
I don't. Well, you may have to use a servo to get through 3 hours. Yeah.
Next question we have here: how do you recommend to introduce meditation to kids?
Okay. Well, first, before we introduce it. I quoted the Dalai Lama earlier about if we could teach every 8-year-old to meditate, we could heal the planet of violence in one generation. You know, you think about all of us, everyone on this call, when we were 5 years old, we saw the world through eyes, of gratitude and joy and happiness and, wanting to play with others and all the things. 10 years later, when the hormones are raging and they were starting to get angry about life or being bullied at school or all our self-limiting beliefs about our looks, our weight, our manhood, our womanhood, whatever it may be, that becomes a whole another set of challenges. So would you repeat the question? It gave me what was the question again?
How do you recommend you introduce meditation to kids?
So if you think about every act of violence, murder, robbery, rape, sexual assault, whatever, that begins in an agitated, angry, jealous, envious mind. So it's really important to get children on a path at an early stage where they are able to manage their emotions. A number of videos on this. I've got a good friend in Houston, Dr. Beth Reese, who's teaching meditation to 5-year-olds as a part of the Houston Independent School District. And then Stephanie Tovar, the Mexican-American young woman I mentioned when I was going through the individual stories, she's focusing on the Latino population in Dallas, starting in the from the first grade to the fifth grade. The Baltimore Public Schools, the Newark Public Schools, both those have a very active yoga and meditation section in their schools. And truancy rates and violence and suspensions have gone way, way down just by the effect of calming the anger and all the stuff that we deal with as teenagers. So in terms of introducing it, I think as a parent, I would sit down with them, depending on their age, of course, and say, you know, we're going to sit down here and relax for just a minute. So I want you to join me. And you explain to them, we're going to do this for 5 minutes. And then you can go along with that, you know, once you think you've got them on the right sheet of music with you.
And one final question for you. I think this is a good one for us to wrap up with. How has your daily well-being routine changed from when you started your professional journey to now?
Well, pre the six pillars, and understanding the real importance of mind fitness. As I mentioned, I'd always been physically fit. The political career and then 30 years in business, and I was working for a global company and flying all over the world and dealing with jet lag and living off airplane food and trying to negotiate deals with companies and all the stress that goes with that. So my particular way of coping was to eat. I never had trouble with alcohol or pills, but for example, I'm 40 pounds less now than I was 3 years ago or four years ago. Coping with binge eating was always my problem. So now, that I understand more the importance of mind fitness, I'm sleeping well, eating properly, my weight's under control. I hope that I'm, behaving better out with my friends. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. And I said that was the last one, but there's one more here. Okay. What do you think is a sign of a breaking point when you're dealing with the ASAP feeling?
Right. Well, you mean the Lucy moment? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's a tough one. Obviously if you're thinking about suicide, that's a very dramatic one. You find yourself becoming over reliant on pills or alcohol or food. By the way, just speaking of food, just as a side, I think I failed to mention this. We are now the United States of America, second only to Mexico in obesity, second only to Mexico on the entire planet. So it's just not pills and alcohol. It's also food. I don't know how to answer that other than, that when it just becomes too much to bear and you find yourself doing something that you know is not in your overall best interest, either the destruction it's going to do to your body or the most extreme one, which is taking your life. I guess that would be the best answer to it.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Alan. We are just about at time here. So I want to thank everyone for joining us today and for participating. We had a very active chat, but let's all thank Alan Steelman for his excellent presentation and insight. We really appreciate you being here and sharing this with us.
Well, thanks to all of you. Thanks very much.
Enjoy. Thanks for joining, everybody.
Okay, bye-bye.